Hello everyone, welcome to lesson 68 of our Golang course. The last lesson was an introduction to concurrency and its challenges. In this lesson, we are going to cover more of those challenges. We touched upon race condition and how to work around them using mutexes or locks. In this lesson, we will cover some problems related to mutexes. Deadlocks, livelocks, and starvation issues happen in a concurrent system where multiple processes are trying to access the same resource. First, let us cover deadlocks. Deadlock occurs when two or more processes are blocked on waiting for the resource held by each other. For example, process X is holding a resource 1 while waiting for resource 2. Then, process Y is holding on resource 2 while waiting for resource 1. This means neither A can proceed nor B, creating a deadlock between the two. Think of it like two kids fighting for a candy, where one kid is saying to another kid that if you want to have the orange candy, give me the mango candy first, while the second kid is saying that if you want to have a mango candy, first give me the orange candy, essentially creating a deadlock between the two. Now let's look at what Kaufman conditions are. Kaufman conditions are a set of four conditions that should be met for a deadlock to happen. If either of them are not met, a deadlock cannot happen. These conditions are used by programs like the Go runtime to detect deadlocks and by developers to prevent deadlocks. The first condition is mutual exclusion. It says that there must be at least one resource that can only be held by one process at a time. Then the next condition is hold and wait. A process should be able to hold on to a resource while waiting for the other resource. Then there should be no preemption. Once a process is holding a resource, it cannot be forcibly taken away by the system. Resource can only be released voluntarily by holding process. And the last one is circular wait, which says there must exist a circular chain of waiting processes where each process is waiting for a resource held by the next process in the chain. So these four conditions encompass the Kaufman conditions. And remember, if either one of them is not true, then you won't have a deadlock. Now let's talk about some limitation with the Kaufman conditions. Please note, while Kaufman conditions are necessary for a deadlock to occur, they are not sufficient. Even if all four conditions are met, it doesn't guarantee a deadlock will happen. The actual occurrence depends on the specific timing and execution sequence of a process. The Kaufman conditions were originally defined for systems with single instances of resource. In systems with multiple instances of resources, deadlock might still occur even if some conditions are not strictly met. So even though Kaufman conditions can help us detect deadlock and prevent it, there are these limitations that should be taken into account. So you should be very careful when working with concurrent code to prevent deadlocks. Now let us look at some code examples. Here, in our package main, I will create two mutexes, mutex1 and mutex2. So let's first create the mutex. So here we have mutex1 and mutex2. Mutex1 will be used by one process to lock a resource, while mutex2 will be used by another process to lock a resource. Now let us create two functions to simulate those processes. Now to simulate the deadlock, let us create two Go routines for resource1 and resource2. So as you can see in the main, first we are launching a goroutine with resource1 function passing in goroutine1, then the second with resource2 and passing goroutine2 as the name. Then we wait using the select, but this won't happen because we have created a condition for deadlock, and as such, Go runtime will panic as it can detect the deadlock. Now let us run our program to see what happens. Go run main.go, and as you can see, the program crashed straight away. Let us go through the output now. As you can see, goroutine 2 acquired resource 2 and goroutine 1 acquired resource 1, and then they both kept waiting for each other. So we got message printed, all goroutines are asleep, deadlock. So this is one example of how deadlock can happen. Just to revise it, let us go through the code again. Here we have two resources, resource 1 and resource 2, protected by separate mutexes. That is mutex1 and mutex2. First, resource1 tries to acquire mutex2 after acquiring mutex1 by calling resource2. Conversely, resource2 tries to acquire mutex1 after acquiring mutex2. This creates a circular dependency and each coroutine is holding one mutex and waiting for the other, resulting in a deadlock. As neither coroutine can proceed, the program becomes stuck. Now let us look at how deadlock can be prevented. To prevent a deadlock, please ensure that in your program, locks are required in the same order. This avoids circular waiting. You can also make sure that at least one of the Kaufman condition is not satisfied, preventing a deadlock. Now let us look at livelocks. Livelocks are similar to deadlocks, but the difference is that processes are continuously changing state without actually making any progress. Even though the processes are changing state, which wasn't the case with deadlock, neither of the process can proceed, as such aren't making any progress. Example, two processes constantly trying to acquire the same resource from each other, but due to timing or other factors, they never succeed in both obtaining their desired resources. As such, they are stuck in a loop of requesting and releasing resource without ever completing the task they have. Think of it, if you have someone coming in front of you and you are trying to give them space, you move to one direction. If they move to the same direction, you are blocked. But then you try again to move to the other direction, but this time again, they move to the other direction, again causing a live lock. Because even though you both are changing positions, you are stuck in a lock. That's essentially what a live lock is. Now let us look at an example. I've already written the code, so I'm just going to remove our existing code and paste the code for live lock. Before going through the code, please keep in mind that you may be seeing a lot of these keywords and functionality for the first time. Don't worry too much about it. We will cover them in future lesson. For now, we are just going to use these to cover our examples. Here in the code, we have two routines, that is routine 1 and routine 2, and two mutexes, mutex A and mutex B. Inside the function routine A, we try to acquire mutex A first, then mutex B, which we do on line 21. On the other side, we have routine B, which tries to acquire mutex B first, then mutex A. If either routine cannot acquire the second mutex due to other routine holding it, it performs a backoff using this recursion, and inside it, we are waiting for some time and then retries to acquire both the mutexes in the same order. This indeed creates a situation where both routines keep trying to acquire each other's held mutexes, resulting in a loop without any actual progress being made. These are live and not deadlocked, but are not doing any meaningful work. And this is from where the name livelocks come from. Let's now try to run our program. And as you can see in the main, we are doing a similar thing. We are calling routine A in a separate goroutine and routine B in a separate goroutine. Let's now run the program to see the output. And as you can see, we have a similar thing. As you can see, B has mutex B, A has mutex A. A is then trying to acquire mutex B, but A cannot acquire mutex B, so it backs off. In the meantime, B is trying to acquire mutex A, but it cannot, as such, it backs off. And they are stuck in a loop of trying to acquire the second lock. So this is very similar to deadlock, but the only difference is that the state of each process is changing, but no actual progress is being made. How do you prevent live locks? One way to prevent this live lock is to ensure that routines acquire mutexes in specific order. Example, always acquire mutex A before mutex B. That is, in both the routines, we try to access mutex A before mutex B. So instead of a busy waiting loop in the try lock case, we could have used channels or other synchronization mechanisms to avoid continuous tries. Again, these terms may not make sense to you at this moment, but we will cover them in future lesson. Now let us look at our next problem, which is starvation. Starvation occurs when one process is denied a resource by another high priority process. The lower priority process will keep waiting to operate on the resource. So you are essentially starving the lower priority process for the resource. Starvation is a problem that is seen not only in concurrent programming, but anywhere where resources are shared. Example, databases, operating system CPUs, etc. Let us look at an example for the same. In this program, you can see we have a high priority function. Before that, we created a mutex and a counter. The high priority function acquires a lock, then sleeps for 100 seconds, increasing the counter, and then unlocking. While the low priority process is acquiring the lock, increasing the counter right away, and then unlocking. As such, the high priority process is acquiring the lock for a longer duration, essentially preventing the lower priority lock to work on it. And in the main, we simulate work by starting a for loop and then calling high priority and low priority function in a goroutine. We sleep for 1 second so that both the goroutines are completed and then print the final counter value. If you run the program, you will see that it just runs fine. But in reality, you can see high priority process is making the low priority process wait for 100 microseconds. In production applications, this could be a longer duration. Let's now look at how starvation can be prevented. First one is scheduling algorithms, which determine which processes get access to the resource, like the CPU. Using a priority queue ensures processes with higher priority are served first, but this also helps prevent lower priority processes from being starved of resources. Then we have the aging technique. Aging is a technique where the priority of the waiting process gradually increases the longer it waits for a resource. This ensures that even the low priority processes eventually get a chance to run and avoid starvation. Then we have the fair resource allocation. Random allocation of resource can lead to starvation for some processes. Instead, resource manager should strive for fair allocation strategy that considers factors like importance and waiting time, thus preventing starvation. Let's now summarize everything we have learned in this lesson. We saw that deadlocks, livelocks, and starvation are very common problems faced by concurrent programming. But if you are careful, we have some measures that you can put in place to prevent them. As we cover more advanced topics, you will see Go has done some excellent work to prevent these issues. That's it for this lesson. I hope you liked it. If you have any questions, please post a comment under the video or reach out to our Discord server. Until next time, happy coding!